Today's episode of The Michele Show is brought to you by usgoldcoins.com, 1-800-HOT-COIN, and Meze Grill, MEZEGrill.com, and TradeHill.com.
Hi guys, welcome to the second episode of The Michele Show. Today's Tuesday, July 19th, and boy do we have a hot topic for you today. Today's topic is the subject of going Dutch, also known as splitting the bill, and who's right and who's wrong. I mean, women and men have completely different opinions on this topic. It's affected all of us at one point, and I thought it was important to have an open conversation with a number of people just to get a different opinion, and hopefully it'll give you some guidance as to how to make the decision next time you're in the situation. Joining me today is Ed Gell.
Hello.
Bruce Wagner.
Hello.
Chris Diego.
Hey.
And the founder of DebtSmart.com, the money king himself,
Scott Bilker.
Scott Bilker.
Hi, Michele. Hello, everybody. Glad to be here.
I have to notice that it's all boys you got here.
I got all boys here today because I have enough to say about the topic for all the women in the audience.
You can speak for all women.
I can speak for all women.
Okay.
Definitely. This is a very, it's a layered topic because it doesn't just affect dating. It also affects how we approach the group scenario. What happens when you go to dinner or go out to a nightclub with a group of people and suddenly the bill comes and it's over $1,000. Not everybody ate or drank the same amount. And, you know, somebody usually leaves the party being really upset. So
they're all in the, half of them are in the bathroom all of a sudden.
I always end up with the alcoholics that I don't drink, and then the big, yeah. I was telling Chris earlier that, you know, I have a knack for, I can spot when the waiter's coming, and I just say, oh, excuse me, I'll be right back, and I go to the restroom.
And you go to the restroom?
For 30 minutes.
That is just wrong. That is just wrong.
No, I'm kidding.
But Scott, a number of years ago, Scott actually did a survey on trends along the lines of this topic, and, you know, how people approach the group scenario. And I think he has some really interesting insight as to what the protocol is when you find yourself in that situation. How do you make the decision, you know, when the check comes as to who pays what? What do you think, Scott?
Well, I mean, the best thing to do really is think about it before you go. What a lot of people do is they'll even ask the server when they approach the table whether they can do separate checks. But if you're just going and you don't know ahead of time, you kind of want to prepare yourself by, you know, knowing who you're going with, because you don't want to end up being upset with, you know, your friends.
But isn't it kind of an uncomfortable topic to the point where people just don't even bring it up to their friends? Like, nobody, who puts in the call to the rest of the group to say, how are we going to manage this situation?
Well, typically no one does, but there are other protocol. I mean, if you invite everyone out to some type of event, then you might have more responsibility depending on that kind of an event. However, if it's just everyone getting together for dinner, what you want to do is kind of survey what people are eating or what people are going to order, because in the event that you're going to split the tip with the entire dinner with everyone, if everyone orders around the equal amount, then if they split the tip evenly, you're all right. But if you're there trying to eat on a budget and you're ordering like a salad and I'm ordering, you know, filet mignon and lobster tail and a few drinks, you know, the person who orders the salad's paying for my great meal. So if you're the one that's on the budget, kind of get a feel for what everyone wants. You can just easily say as you're looking through the menu, so what interests you? You know, if someone's like, well, I'm going to have the filet mignon, then you might...
Is that your cue to order the lobster? Is that your cue to order the lobster when the guy next to you is ordering the filet mignon?
Right, or ordering like 10 shots of something, then you want to think about what you're ordering. You're just drinking iced tea.
Yeah. I'll have 10 shots, but I'll start with two.
Yeah, well, you know, I've been in this situation before where we're out with a group and maybe it's multiple couples, and suddenly there's always one or two guys that get up and go to the bathroom, you know, when the check is coming. I mean, am I the only person this has happened to?
No.
No.
People also leave early. They're like, oh, I'm sorry, I gotta go somewhere. Kiss, kiss, kiss. Great to see you.
Right, and they just take off.
Here's $10. And it's like, because what I ordered was $10 or something, and yeah, they take off. But what you want to describe what we do? Because we have the Sunday brunch ritual that we do every single week. And it's always different people, a different group of people. I wanted you to explain how we do that.
Well, it's not that strange, I don't think. We pretty much all get along, and we know that everyone pretty much covers most of their bill. And every so often, yeah, I have to pay a few more dollars. But for me, $4 or $5 is not the same as paying a whole meal for someone. That's just paying an extra little tip.
But what we do is, like, we kind of make it a ritual, because we do it every week. We just make it a ritual. We have this little formula based on the sales tax and the tip in New York. It's, 1.25. So we just say whatever your total is times 1.25, and that's what you leave. That should include a nice, you know, like a 17% tip or something or more, and, or 17.5, and the tax and tip. So with that, we're able to, so we actually, somebody's like designated calculator, and they're like, what did you have? And then we literally added up for each person, what did you have? This, and we add it up and multiply by 1.25. And then everybody knows their total, and we just kind of
make a game out of it. And that covers the tip.
Yeah, it includes the tax and the tip. That's the important thing, is that people have to know it. You got to include the tax and the tip.
Well, that's a great approach, because you're going to include the tip if you include that 25% extra.
Right. Well, and in their particular Sunday brunch scenario, Scott, they have this event every Sunday, pretty much. So it's the same group of people. They understand each other. They know each other's constraints, and you know, it's not an uncomfortable topic. But I find that more often than not, we're put in a situation where you're with a new group, or there are new people in the group, and it just becomes, you know, it becomes a topic of conversation after the event, where you're calling up your friends and saying, what was up with that guy? He got up and went to the bathroom.
Right.
Yeah. Or so-and-so, you know, ate $50, you know, worth of food and didn't pay nearly as much as everyone else.
Yeah.
It's, if you have a situation where you don't know everyone who's there, then it's going to really complicate things. And then you have to decide really who's going to take responsibility, because when the bill comes, you know, whoever touches it first is now going to be responsible for all the math and collection or deciding on what's going on. Yeah. Or you can try to pass it around and everyone puts in, you know, what they want. Or sometimes people will kind of just dictate, like, you know, everyone throw in this much. But it can also work in reverse. I've been in situations where, like, I'll pay with my credit card and everyone gives me cash and I'll end up with more money than I had.
Yeah,
that's a rarity.
Bill comes. Credit card bill comes, you're not so happy. You know, I've actually seen people do this. It's so weird. But, you know, we've seen people do that. Like, I don't know the psyche, whatever, but actually not order, like, oh, no, I'm not hungry. I'm not going to have anything. And then, or they'll just have, like, a little tiny thing. I'll just have a cup of soup. That's it. And then somebody else has this huge meal. And then, like, two-thirds of it is left over. And they're like, oh, well, there's plenty. No, help yourself. And then they, like, eat half of it. You know, and it's like, okay, this is interesting, because I mean, they ate half of this, you know, whatever, $25 dinner, and then the bill comes, and they're like, oh no, I only had my little cup of soup.
I had a friend like that. Yeah,
right?
We used to go out to the diner. Right? Everyone ate.
Are
eight
you
of
serious?
Us, eight of us. He would like, no, I'm okay. I'm not gonna get.
And
anything.
Then he would just eat
he
the leftovers.
He would finish everybody's thing. It made me sick. I called him a pig once.
I've never even heard of that. That's a totally new scenario.
Yeah.
See, there's a twist.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. No, I've run across that scenario. And you know, it that again kind of depends. I mean, if you ask, hey, can I have some of that, and eat half the meal, well, then you should pay something. But at the same time, I've had, you know, people are like, you know, I don't want any more of this. You know, does anyone want some? And if they give it away, well, then they give it away. And whoever else is there really doesn't need to pay for it.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's move on to the real controversial topic.
The most controversial.
But wait. I wanted to add to that part where there's another scenario where I think it's, well, I have two scenarios, but one of them is when someone, whoever ate the most usually, suggests at the very end, why don't we just split it all halfway? Like, if there's 10 people, split it into 10. It's like, I'm the first one to raise my hand and say, absolutely not.
After five drinks,
you know,
an entree, and a
you
salad,
don't
and
ask for
drink.
That after the fact. You should, like you said, agree beforehand.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then the other thing is that if, like, you know, when people go out to eat, they, you know, I guess with us, they always come to me and then I, you know, itemize everything at the end and I give them the bill. But there's always someone in the group that that wants to, like, I don't know, like...
Split the bill evenly, if they've had to, it happens like that. I'll have a, you know, like you're trying to be frugal and you're like, I'm just going to have a salad. You know, I've got a budget. And it's an expensive restaurant or whatever the thing is. And then somebody's like, okay, I'm going to have drinks and hors d'oeuvres and appetizers and meals and all these things and dessert and drinks and drinks. And then let's just split it four ways. Is that okay? Yeah. I was like, wow.
Yeah.
Wait a minute.
Yeah, what I was going to say was that, like, I know this is kind of tacky on my part, but like if I'm paying, then I think I have the choice to decide how much I'm going to spend on whoever I'm inviting.
Right.
I mean, I try to be, you know, nice, but sometimes if I have a budget, then I have a budget. So, like, I'll go to a specific place because they have a certain special, and I'll say, well, we're all going to order the special today, and this is what we're all going to have.
He does.
And then that way I know for sure that I'm only going to spend so much money, and it always works out well, so that works pretty well.
Well, just to add to that, like, one time I had a birthday party. I didn't want anyone to feel like they had to contribute to the bill because I invited them. And I didn't want any awkwardness. So I invited them to one of my favorite restaurants in New York City that actually offers a prefix menu for mm-hmm. that kind of event.
Right.
So that way you can completely control what they drink and what they eat, even though they will have a variety to choose from.
Right.
And there is no awkwardness. If anything, at the end, when my guests saw that I was trying to pay the bill, they were rushing up to me trying to contribute to the bill.
Right.
I didn't take anybody's money that day. But maybe later. Next time I will.
Gift cards, cash, plan
these things in advance. You know, if you can do something like that and plan in advance, that's always your best scenario. Now, in the study that I did, in the survey that I did, I found that 37% of people said that they do split the bill. 31% said they have separate tabs. So for the most part, you're going to be in that, you know, almost 70% in that group of either splitting the bill or having separate tabs. I always, my philosophy is when you go into that situation, assume everyone's going to just split the bill.
Yeah.
That way you know what to order. You can always bring it home. You know, if you're like, you know what, I'll have that tiramisu to go. If you're like, we're splitting a bill and you know you ordered $5 worth of stuff, say, you know what, I'll have that tiramisu to go. Bring me an order of that. Mm-hmm. Just kind of try to plan for that in advance. A lot of the time, everyone will just put money in, and that'll work out fine too. I mean, if you know what you purchased, you can keep a mental tab yourself. And when everyone asks for money, say, you know, just give them what it should be, and that's it.
Right. I mean, a big factor in this, Scott, is everybody's income situation. Right. You know, the amount of money that everybody's making, and it's important, I think, also to be sensitive. You know, if you're with a group of people mm-hmm. where you know each other, and you know, maybe you know that not everybody in the group is going to be making the same amount of money, right. You want to be sensitive to other people's financial situation. So if you know that you're the broke one in the group, you don't need to be ordering filet mignon under any circumstances, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah.
Unless you can split the tab and not whine about it. Yes,
that's right. True. You can correct. Do that. And also, but I think also too, if you're the rich one in the group, it's important to be sensitive to the people who you know are making minimum wage or they're unemployed for a long time. They just want to hang out with you, but they don't have money to be eating out. And so right. to not go to the 4-star, 5-star places and to, you know, be sensitive of the place you to start out with.
I agree.
Pay $8 for a cheeseburger, not $80, right?
I agree. Yeah.
Another option is, like, a lot of coworkers will go out to lunch, and it might be the same coworkers going all the time, maybe just a few, two or three. In that case, you know, one day one person picks up the tab, another day another person picks up the tab, and everyone looks and feels great about doing it, and in the end, it pretty much will equal out because people will go to places they can afford for everybody.
Yeah. The other scenario, I think, also that happens a lot, I think in our group, which we don't ever end up paying for one specific person, but like I was saying, I'll end up paying like $2 or $3 extra or even $10, and it's because people don't tip equally. And right. if I think that we got great service, I'm always going to tip 20% on my part of the bill. But then these other people, some of them, they think that it's not noticed that they're not tipping at all. And how the heck are you going to know that?
Right.
So you end up short.
Right. Well, I think, you know, one of the biggest reasons why I wanted to have this conversation and have this group here with me also is so that from now on, people, when you find yourself in this scenario, you can feel free to call out your friend that rushed to the bathroom to not pay the bill. You can call them out when, you know, they're ordering a dish that's four times the cost of everybody else. you know, have the conversation because it's beforehand. That's better. Have the conversation beforehand, or if somebody's, you know, somebody's behavior during the outing is just outrageous, right. Call them out on it. That way you avoid having the same, you know, the same problem next time around. You don't want to lose a friendship over somebody's brokenness.
Exactly. You're calling them out to keep the friendship.
Yeah, exactly.
Because a restaurant bill will...
A restaurant bill can, you know, can create animosity between people.
Yeah.
Unfortunately.
Especially if it happens all the time.
Well, I think it should only happen once, really. And, exactly. And then you should definitely let them know. And then the next time you make it for sure that you make separate bills because this person has this behavior pattern that they're probably not going to stop because they've been doing it for a long time usually.
I agree with Scott about, I mean, that when you go to, basically, when you go to a restaurant, you should always assume that we're going to have separate tabs. That's, I mean, even if it's all in one tab, we're going to each pay our own. You just assume that, and I think that's proper.
I would assume you're going to split it.
Yes, split it one way or the other, but I mean, really, I'm going to pay for what I order, you're going to pay for what you order. I mean, that's how I approach it. And then in the end, if I feel like generous and I say, no, it's on me, that's cool. If you feel generous and you say it's on me, then that's a gift. And of course, you know, I accept it or whatever, give it graciously. But it's always, from my part, it's always assumed that I'm going to pay for what I order. And if you do that, if you go into that way, then you're good. But a couple points I want to make. One is, if you ask for, like, physically separate checks, there's often this awkwardness now with the server. They're like, they roll their eyes and like, oh my God, we got, you know, 12 people and they all want a separate check. You feel like you're asking for, you know, free lunch.
It's right. Like in that case, then that tip goes from 20% to 15% right off the top.
Yeah, well.
Okay, well, I'm a waiter.
Yeah, okay. Tell us for the... okay, because Chris is a waiter. Chris is a server himself. Sorry, go ahead.
I'm saying if you all came in separately, she'd have 12 separate checks. What's the problem?
Okay, right? Well, now let's get the server's perspective because Chris is a server. This is perfect.
Well, when it's big parties, it's funny because it looks like a big table of morons. It kind of like, why can't you just do the math? And why don't you can organize with each other? Because there's a lot of different tables throughout the day. And there's some people you could just see it's more of an intellectual status. Like, look how organized they are. Compared to somebody who, right off the bat, when they walk in, you already know how they're going to ask for split checks. The minute they walk in, you can just tell. So I just feel that, yeah, it's just how you...
Yeah, but how do you...
So it is a table full of morons when they ask you.
Yeah, 100%. Like, why can't you just do the math? I don't understand
because
that.
Because I don't have a smartphone. It has no calculator.
Well, it's because you have really people that do this
really
kind
nice
of stuff.
It's really nice when you get a server that comes over and says, hey, you know, is this going to be together or separate checks?
Right.
And that happens.
Yeah, that happens.
I always
appreciate that.
Like I said, if I'm with someone that has done it before, I will insist that they have separate checks. Because it's not fair to everyone else. I mean, I don't mind paying a few dollars, but when everyone else has to take the share, it's not fair.
So it's even when paying the restaurant bill, that's like you showing your reputation. And it could just detrimize your relationship towards people. Just from how your reputation is. So it sucks when, it's a $10 meal that you're skipping off of, but you're actually ruining, you know, a lot of...
Well, you're ruining, you're saying that quite possibly what people perceive of you now has changed. Yeah. Exactly. So you could be a great guy with a great personality, you dress well, we think you make money, and then you walk in and have this big idea of let's all split the check, and that'll leave some people wondering, you know, what's up with this guy Chris?
Exactly.
Right.
Because being cheap, a hot button issue. A lot of people, you know, even in the survey I conducted, you know, a lot of people were upset with those who skipped out or didn't pay their share, or you know, everyone feels that they've been in this situation where that's happened to them. Mm-hmm. So you want to guard against that, like you said, for you know, you don't want to ruin your friendships over. But at the same time, you could take charge also. You could say, hey, listen, I got the thing. Everyone give me whatever.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Yeah.
Okay,
you give me this much and you give me that much or something to that effect.
That's what I do because I think that it's like, I mean, it's on one hand, money is a sensitive thing. People are so sensitive about money. And even if it's a trivial amount, it's $2, $5, $10, whatever, sometimes it's not a trivial amount, but whatever the amount is, it's so silly to lose a relationship or a friendship of people you enjoy hanging out with over a silly little thing like this. So I like to do...
Over a cheeseburger, right?
Yeah,
over a cheeseburger.
It's so silly, right?
Everyone's got one of these. Everyone's got one of these on the phone.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm.
It's not too tough. It, you know,
that one's too complicated for me, but...
You had to end up on a napkin, but today, everyone's got a smartphone.
Well, exactly. The fact of the matter is that this topic and the whole money situation is the number one reason why people break up in the world.
Couples
are plagued by the money situation. So this leads me to the next half of this conversation, the most controversial part of this conversation, which is who should pick up the bill at dinner, at the movies, you know, when you go out on the weekends. I mean, it's different when you've already been in a relationship for some time because, you know, situations change, financial situations change. And I, as a woman, if I'm in a relationship long term, and let's say the guy was well off when we first started dating, but he's going through issues, and I've lived this. This has happened to me before. I don't have a problem picking up the tab and getting us through a rough spot.
Mm-hmm.
So I think I want to put that out there because I'm also the kind of woman that does expect the guy to pick up the tab.
When you're first dating.
Or when I'm first dating. I mean, like, you know, I have a 16-year-old son, and I teach him that when he goes to the movies, if he's with a girl, under no circumstances does she need to be reaching into her purse to pay for tickets, meals, or anything else.
Wow.
And if she brings a friend, I don't want my son allowing the friend to not pay.
Right. Okay? If she's bringing a friend, then it's not a date.
If she's, well... sometimes... we are in a situation where we're going out on a date with our boyfriend and we bring a friend, and then the question is, I mean, I don't think a guy...
It's true too, yeah.
I don't think a guy is forced to pay, but it does impress the girl and it shows initiative on the man's part, you know, to take the role as the head of the group, and it's just the more manly thing to do.
Oh, that's so old-fashioned.
So, Chris, I brought you on the show today because you said... that you usually go Dutch.
On the first date, yeah.
On the first date?
Through experience, through times where I felt like it's almost like I feel like I'm investing on a girl.
Right.
You know, and a lot of times, I'm not talking about with sex. I'm talking about with just hanging out, like, on a blind date, you don't know who this person is. And I've gone all out, like, pulled every card, entertained, did cartwheels.
Right.
And at the end, the girl's like, Like, I'm like, why am I even? And then right there, I'm like, I'm like, all right, we're splitting the check. Like, there's no way I'm going to continue this.
So wait a minute. So you mean, like, you'll take her to the nice restaurant, you'll try to impress her with, you know, the show you put on that night.
I'll tell her five stories, I'll take her around.
If she's not looking excited by the end of the date, she's paying.
Half. Yes. 100%. I'm like, then I start feeling like I'm the prize.
You start feeling like you're the prize.
Yeah, and I have no idea, you know. Like, I'm like, why should I be with her? I'm like, you know. I feel like it's a thin line between being a gentleman and being a chump.
I agree. I agree, and I'll put that out there. I think even though I have an expectation of the man always picking up the bill, especially on the first date, I don't like it either when women that have an expectation like myself have an attitude about it, you know, where they feel like, you know, you have to do it. Or I think it's a luxury today that a man is able to invite you out and pick up the bill every single time.
And you appreciating it, I'm like so ready to do it.
Okay.
Just for a girl appreciating it, I'm like, yeah, all right, you know, like.
But you're saying if she comes across as like nonchalant, she's just not appreciating everything that you went out of your way to do on the date, then more so she can expect to pick up half that tab at the end of the day.
Immediately. Yeah.
Now, when you've done that, because I'm assuming you've done that before. Have women never called you out on it? Has a woman ever said to you, were you crazy? I'm not picking up half the check.
No, sometimes too. I always have, I'll pick up the check, but you take care of the tip. And
okay.
That's more of a, But no, when
I wouldn't get mad about that. I wouldn't get upset about that.
Right, but when I've gone Dutch,
Michele, I think you know, I'm a little old school. I think for sure on the first date, guy picks up the check.
I approve. I approve, Scott.
Jennifer in the chat room saying, "Oh, Chris doesn't get play on the first date."
Yeah.
Hold on. Repeat that, Scott. I couldn't hear you.
There are many women that really want to pay half, and they might even get mad if they can't. So one thing you could always say is the guy is like, "Listen, just get me next time. How about that?"
Well, that is a very interesting point, because there are a lot of women that are very independent that have the opposite mindset,
right,
that they don't want to be made to feel like to feel like the little woman that can't afford her own meal.
Right.
So that's why this is really
mindset, Michele, but inside they still want the guy to pay, just from, you know, an emotional standpoint, I believe. That's my opinion.
I agree.
Sure, they might really want to pay and be independent, but at the same time, they still want to be, you know, treated to the date, just, you know, for tradition's sake. It's still in our society, I think. So a nice way out of that is just simply say, "Get me next time," or you get it next time. And you know, let them next time if they're forceful.
Well, I have a question.
Get you a drink or whatever, that's fine.
I have a question on this, okay. That, you know, we talk about a guy wanting to impress the girl because it impresses her, and she wants the guy to treat her in a certain way. But my question is, maybe it's just me, but why does it have to go one direction? Wouldn't it impress the guy if the girl would? For me, it would impress me if somebody wanted to buy me dinner. I mean, what's wrong with a guy being impressed? What's wrong with a guy being treated?
I don't have a problem.
You want me to buy you dinner? I'll buy you dinner.
I don't.
Are you single?
I don't. That's a whole other topic. Okay. No, listen. I very much believe in surprising the man you love. You know, not necessarily on the first date picking up the tab. Hell no.
What's the difference if it's the first date?
Because
it's something about Cinderella.
Listen, I still believe. Well, you know, I still believe as a woman.
On the first date, then you pay. Then take her out for lobster dinner and let her pay.
You know, the thing is that I still believe as a woman that at the end of the day, most women want to feel that they're with a man, and being with a man means that he's the one. You know, with that's the head of household, so to speak, in more ways than one, mentally, emotionally, financially. I'm a very strong woman. I'm very independent. So it takes a much stronger man than myself to make me feel that way. But at the end of the day, I don't want to feel like, you know, everything falls on me financially either. And I think one way that a man kind of gets that out of the way on the first date is making you feel like he's got you on that first date.
And he's
picking up the bill. Yeah. I mean, it creates, and look, Jennifer said it in the chat a little while ago. She says that more than likely Chris is not getting any play at the end of the first date.
Let me clear this up. I've never got play on the first date. I've never heard of that.
Which is for a chicken or the egg?
Yo, I've never heard of that.
You might want to change your ways.
You might want to change your ways, and let me tell you why. Every woman that's got this is important.
Okay, well,
this is a profound thought I'm going to give you right now, as your friend and as the host of this show. Every woman you've ever dated has been on at least 20 other dates.
Uh-huh.
So by default, you're being compared to every other scenario she's been on, and 9 times out of 10, she's never had to pay for dinner or for that first date. So, you know, unfortunately, I hate to say it, but you have a better chance of getting play at the end of the date by, you know, romancing her, whining and dining her, and making her feel like $1 million, even if you're broke.
Okay, now wait, the business, and I'm so glad that came from Michele, from the girl on the panel, who's admitting, speaking for all ladies,
right.
That you actually are going to have a better chance to get some play.
I believe so. I believe so.
What's your definition of play, though? If it's like a kiss, I'll change.
It's what foreplay.
Don't go out with
play.
At some point, you're going to be found out, and it's over.
It's true.
Look, if she's that bad and she doesn't know your name, you could always run out the back door.
Who cares? By the next day, who cares? If there's a second date,
she's that terrible.
Yeah.
When listen, on a first date,
you're asking her out, so you know, typically the man wants to go on the date. Look, if the girl's asking for the date and begging you because you're just, you know,
that happens to me all the time.
Then, look, if she wants to go out and she's begging you, well, that might be something different, but that's very typically the guy wants to go on the date, he's asking her, guy should pay.
So let's get down to the bottom, the brass tacks. Is it a business deal? Is it really a business transaction that you're buying someplace? Okay, because I could just, like, if they take Bitcoin or cash or credit cards, you know, it's just simpler. I mean,
it's not. Look, it's absolutely not. We're not talking prostitution.
No.
We're talking about on a first date, making a woman feel, one, like a woman, and making her feel like she wants to go there with you. I can guarantee that if you make her pick up half the tab, you might have to wait 5 more dates before you get some play.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
Because for her time spent with you is also an investment for a future potential relationship.
So it's my contention.
Hold on a second.
Wait.
If it's only 5 more times, then maybe you should split the bill.
Exactly. Like the layaway plan. Yeah,
5 times, that's not so bad.
Well, listen, another layer of this, a question I want to ask you, in the gay community, when it's 2 men that are dating, how is the decision made?
Well, you know, it's a little bit different because the play happens before the date. You know, the first thing is, like, we negotiate about the sexual adult things. And then we do that. And then we find, what was your name again? You know, we find their names. And then, you know, if everything really works out long term, then we go on a date. And that's how that happens. So we get that part out of the way. But the play
is not an issue.
No, because that's just going to happen and there's no need for any financial compensation. See, the other thing is, I have to contend, like, cut through the BS and say, look, it really is a transaction. Now, even if it's not necessarily, you know, sex for money or whatever, if you want to be so blunt, but to say that there really is a transaction, I don't care what, if you're describing this old school type of relationship on a first date, it is a transaction, because even if it's just about feelings versus play, even if it's about feelings, not the money directly, but the feelings, if you're making her feel like a princess and she is the most wonderful special princess in the world, then she's getting what she wants. She wants to feel that way.
Yes.
Right.
And then you want to feel your way, and that's what happens, and it becomes a transaction. Am I right?
I don't totally disagree. I don't totally disagree with that. I mean, listen, a woman, when she wants to impress a man, she'll go out and she'll buy the best dress she can find. She'll wear the most expensive perfume, you know, because she wants to look good for her man too and impress him as well.
Right.
You know, I think the whole idea behind the first date is that we're all trying to get somewhere, whether it's a relationship, whether it's in the sack, you know, or whether it's just a free meal.
Right. You see right there, right when you said that.
It's just
I'm telling you. You smiled a mile away. Like, that's why I'm like, all right. Like, if she comes out on a first date and she's wearing a cardigan, I'm like, uh-uh. There's no way. This is, I don't know what this is, but like, I'm figuring out it's a huge strategy type thing. Now, what you're speaking of, I think, is a generational thing. It sounds like it's very formulaic. And if it was formulaic, I would love that because it sounds so much easier.
Right.
But nowadays, there's so much reverse psychology. And so it's just been done so many times that now it's just another level, another layer of things.
Yeah.
To the point where I even feel like I'm at a bar.
Hold on.
And I
have to say that, you know, if dating is about dating and it shouldn't be about worrying too much about who's paying the bill. If you got to worry about who's paying the bill,
it's not a worry thing. It's actually kind of fun when you get into this.
Well, but Scott, I don't think that guys worry about it as much as women do, because I think when a woman is put in a situation where she's having to pay half the bill, let's say on the first date, you better believe that she may not have caused controversy with that candidate that night, so to speak, but she's calling all her girlfriends and talking about how she just went out with a loser.
Yeah.
So the conversation is going on behind the scenes, and, you know, that could turn into, well, now the guy's wondering why he called her and she never picked up the phone again.
That's why I like the gay method. We get it out of the way. And the money, we keep the money separate from the sex, separate from the dinner, and it's, you know, get that out of the way. It's just, it keeps it.
You know what, it's just like, you know, any product. you get a good product, you tell 5 people. But if you're really mad and you get a bad product, you tell 30.
Mm. Yeah. Client, in this case, the client who doesn't pay the bill.
Ooh, that's good.
Listen, listen, Scott. I've had some so bad dating experiences that I wish I could call a Better Business Bureau on these guys.
There needs to be a Better Business Bureau, a better dating bureau.
Listen, maybe on debtsmart.com we can have like a department completely dedicated to taking complaints.
Complaint department.
But listen, Scott, you did a search. There was also a compatibility test I found on your site that could, within couples, you can check to see just how compatible you are in your ideals about how to approach money.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, right. I think if a lot more people really, you know, took the time to take a compatibility test and figure out if they're really compatible, it would save everybody a lot of hassle.
Yeah, that's
Tell us a little bit more about the compatibility test.
Well, you know, you want to make sure that the way you think about finances lines up. Some people are fine with having separate money, you know, his money, her money, and their money, and other people want to just combine it all. So, and some people are big spenders and some people are big savers. So you want to make sure that the person you're with, you know, has the same kind of philosophy when it comes to dealing with their finances. I mean, that might not be the only thing you have to worry about, but it's certainly a large thing, because trouble with money is the number one reason for divorce. I think you mentioned that earlier, but that is the number one reason why people have troubles. Money, infidelity is after that.
Yeah, but it seems like when you match up to people, it always seems like you're matching up the opposite. Like, if you're really good at finances, your partner not necessarily is really good at it, and that's your dominant feature. So I don't know about, you know, the compatibility. It doesn't always work, I don't think.
You wouldn't want two people who are bad at finances. There's usually always one that's better than the other.
Fine, as long as the person who's not as good listens. But everyone needs to be included. My feeling is, you know, everyone's got to be included. Even if one person is handling all the money, they've got to lay it out all on the table so that everyone knows where the money is and what's going on. And
yeah.
And someone's not just a giant spender.
Let's take a minute to thank our sponsors, because we've gotten so caught up in this fantastic conversation, we lost track of time.
This is going to be a 3-hour show. But yeah, we do want to thank our sponsors, because without them, we wouldn't be here to have all this fun with you. So we want to thank usgoldcoins.com at 1-800-HOT-COIN. That's Andy Gauss, who is actually a monetary expert. He's a genius when it comes to money and investing in rare U.S. gold and silver coins. It's called Numismatic Gold and Silver Coins as Investments. And he's actually bringing his show, The Real World of Money, to Only One TV Network on Wednesday mornings at 10 a.m. Coming soon, I think the Wednesday after next. And his name is Andy Gauss, but we trust him implicitly. If you want to diversify your savings and investments into something that is really going to grow in value two ways, because it's rare and because it's gold or silver, then check them out. We really, really recommend them and trust them implicitly. Andy Gauss at usgoldcoins.com, 1-800-HOT-COIN, and Mezi Grill, that's M-E-Z-E Grill, mezigrill.com, where authentic Mediterranean food meets modern flavor. And that's our friend Marwan. He's awesome. They've got the best food. We've discovered them because it's one of Ed and I's favorite restaurants. It's just 3 blocks south of Columbus Circle. So if you live in New York, or you're visiting, you're passing through, don't forget to check out Mezi Grill. They're awesome food. And, of course, they're famous now because they're the world's first restaurant, brick-and-mortar restaurant, that accepts Bitcoin. If you don't know about Bitcoin, check out the Bitcoin show on Only One TV, and you'll learn all about that. Mezi Grill, we thank them for sponsoring. And Trade Hill. Trade Hill, TradeHill.com. And what TradeHill.com is an exchange site where you can actually buy Bitcoins. So now that you know what Bitcoins are, you check it out. And this is how you buy Bitcoin without leaving the comfort of your own home. And you'll get 10% off of the trade fees, which are minuscule anyway. You get 10% off those trade fees for life if you use the referral code for the Michele Show, which is TH, as in Trade Hill, dash R, like referral, 141. It's on the screen now, TH-R141, TradeHill.com, the easiest way to buy and sell Bitcoins online. We thank our sponsors. Be sure and thank them for sponsoring the Michele Show on Only One TV, and we appreciate them.
Yeah, Jennifer in the chat room, she's got a few good points. She says you can only make one first impression, which I totally
Correct.
Agree with. And no, it's not about that. Women just want to be charmed and feel special. Mm-hmm. which I totally agree. And Art, and Art chimes in and says, and they should be, enough said. And then
and they should be enough said. But they don't want to feel charmed at McDonald's. I know this for sure. If you take them to the drive-thru, they don't feel... You can tell them that they're in a carriage and they're a princess.
And, they're going to and the that just isn't going to cut it.
Yeah. Fries with that, please.
Chris,
if you're 12 years old, then McDonald's will work, but otherwise it's not happening.
If you're 12 years old.
Oh, yeah, that's a whole other topic there. So, Scott, are you dating 12-year-olds? No.
Well, go ahead. You were going
to wanted to ask Chris, because Chris said, well, do you feel that they don't always want to, or you, do you think that some women just take advantage?
I feel like no. I feel like women, since they were 5 years old, have been getting compliments on how pretty they are, all these things. You can't just keep doing that because it doesn't sound like anything. I understand, like, deep down at heart, they want to feel special and charmed, but you can't. You gotta be careful with complimenting them. It's just a thin line. You can't there's a thin line. You just can't just say.
How do you make them feel special without just complimenting them? You're so beautiful.
There's other ways, so
money,
I guess.
You know, and here's the money. I'm going to take you to the 5-star place and you're pretty. That, it, how can you make them feel special without just buying it?
No.
No, I'm not saying that either.
No.
Or complimenting them.
Well, what he's saying, because beautiful women, like what you're talking about, is that they grow up getting complimented all the time. And being made to feel special all the time. So you think that if you come along as a new guy in their life and just continue that pattern of behavior, doesn't make you different from the rest of the guys?
I feel like the majority of women can't take a compliment.
Really?
It's weird. They always feel weird. I'm like, yo, I'm just saying. And it's always just like nervous. I'm like, all right. Now
you think it makes them uncomfortable?
Very, yeah.
Because they think you're trying to go somewhere with it.
Yeah, and I'm like, all right, I don't know.
Which you are, of course.
It's like
Well, actually, 100%.
What's the point?
Every 7 seconds in my head, 100%. Yeah. That's no lie, but...
7 milliseconds.
And that's what I was going to comment about you, like about gay men. It's like, why the relationship are like that? It's because it's two men.
Two, yeah.
That's it. Like,
two accelerators and no brakes.
Yeah.
wait, but you're saying, Chris, is the reason why the gay men, when we talked earlier.
Gay men go straight to the sex, it sounds like.
Well, there's no underlying, you know, issues like women.
No games.
There are no games. I mean,
agree on them.
Well, no games in the sense that when I'm assuming that when two men are going to have sex, you don't have the underlying issue that you do with women in my reputation. What is he going to think of
exactly.
me? Does he think that I do this with everybody?
That's the games.
Those are the games right. that women, you know, that exist.
Right. I mean, gay men are like, does he think I do this with everybody? Of course we do. We all do.
but then doesn't it, when it comes to finances.
Michelle? The bottom line on the dating is that it's more than just paying. It's treating her like a woman from the beginning. You know, opening the door, pulling out the chair.
Chivalry. Yes.
Paying for the meal. It's the whole thing. If the whole package is not complete, it's not going to work out well for you.
Yeah.
Scott is probably getting some play on the first date. No, because listen, for women, because women are more emotional than they are visual or physical. I agree 100%, Scott, that it's all in the details. It's not even just about picking up the bill, because if you pick up the bill and you're arrogant or you're obnoxious or you're not, you know, sensitive to these other things that you just mentioned, you know what? You're not going to get any props for having picked up the bill either.
Right. It's the whole chivalry. It's the whole thing of making them feel special. It's consideration. It's thoughtfulness about feelings. See, because
thoughtfulness women, and paying the bill is part of that thoughtfulness.
Yeah. It's about the thought and the feelings that go into it. And for guys, it's strictly we know what it is. See, like when a woman wants to impress a guy, she buys what? Lingerie. Okay, when a guy wants to impress a girl, he buys her, you know, flowers and rings and romantic, beautiful, flowery things. I mean, you know, that are going to express, like, a greeting card or anything that is going to express his feelings. So she's getting fed with feelings. He's getting fed with whatever came in the lingerie. So, you know, that's what they want. It's a transactional thing, see? And it's different. I mean, it's there's it's. But the thing is that men and women have to play this game because they're not both wanting the same thing at the same time as much. It's weird. Like with gay guys or whatever, you know, they both want sex, they both want sex, that's that. They both want to be treated with respect. Of course, we treat each other with respect and we're gentlemen towards each other and we do, you know, wonderful things to each other and let them know that we're, you know, that we love them and they're special and all that. But you know, but it's separate. It's not like I'm going to give you this for that. I give you this, you give me this.
Well, I also think that, you know, men and women, and this is a whole separate topic for another show, men and women's thought processes are completely different.
Yeah.
You could tell me that you like how this dress looks on me, and I'll wonder if you really meant that I look fat in the dress. Oh, you know what I mean? Dude. So when I'm assuming that in a gay relationship with two men, it's really not as complicated in the thought processes as it can be between a man and a woman.
Oh, for sure. We're much more blunt about it.
Yeah. But I mean, where...
The other thing, Ellie brings up a good point, because I think that women obviously invest a lot into dating. Like she says, women pay for their clothes, they make up perfumes, manicures to look good for their dates, etc. Men don't do that.
No.
So women already on the date have invested like lots of money and time to look good and to pay for all these great things. And then, yeah, of course, they're almost like expecting to... for their dinner to be paid after going through all that trouble.
I will tell you this. Women, I think, will get offended, to add to what Ellie is saying. Women will get offended at the idea that the man is not even going out of his way to impress her. Yeah. After all the trouble she went through.
That's right.
To get dressed and to look good for him and, you know, to show up for the day. I think it has more to do with that than anything else. That I, as a woman, if I feel that I bring a lot to the table... I'm going to take it as you don't even want to impress me, that you're going to make me pay for half the check. And yes, a lot of times the guy will show up on the date, you know, looking half as good, you know, as the woman, because he just didn't invest the same kind of time and money.
That's right.
Into it.
Well, that's a great point.
What do you think about that?
A lot of new, young... Michele, have you had any first dates where the guy doesn't pay or made you pay?
You know something? I have not. I actually have not. I have not been in a situation where... I've been on a first date and the guy has made me pay. No, but I've been in many situations where from that point on, you know, as the relationship, because I just don't have luck, you know, to go out with guys that are wealthy or that have a lot of money or that always want to pick up the bill. But by that time, I'm emotionally invested in the yes. I've been in many situations where after you surpass the first date and, you know, whether we've been seeing each other a month or a few months, where I've ended up, you know, picking up the bill on more than one occasion because of their financial situation. Now,
and how do you feel about that? How do you feel about that?
Well, I don't feel completely bad about it, and I'll tell you why. If I think that the guy that I'm dating brings a lot of other things to the table, if he turns me on mentally, if he takes care of me emotionally, if I think he's got potential, if I think that maybe he's just going through a rough spot, and I believe in him, I absolutely do not have a problem with that.
Yeah.
Even though as a woman, in a perfect world, I want the guy to always pick up the tab. I think all women in a perfect world want that. But in the real world that we live in, I absolutely don't have a problem with, you know, carrying us financially as a couple if I have to for a certain period of time. If I really love the person I'm with, I believe in them, and I think they bring a lot of other things to the table.
So there's a positive and a negative that you can learn from Michele's story. First, always have the guy fill out a questionnaire before you date him like she does and interview them. And secondly, you know, don't date the pool boy because eventually you're going to end up supporting them.
Well, no. Michele, let me ask you something further. Like, how far along the relationship would you have to go? Because you said that you had no problem paying at a certain point, but it still doesn't feel... exactly right. But how far would it have to be for you before you paying wouldn't matter? Like, you wouldn't think of it in any way, in a negative way at all.
Okay. I, you know, just for the record, I have not engaged in real long-term relationships throughout the course of my adult life. So most of my relationships tend to last only a few months. Anyways. So I've been put in that position, Scott. I've been put in that position, Scott, as early as a month in. Let's say I'm 1 month in, and now...
That's a little too short. That's too short for the guy to not, you know...
Well, but you know what happens? And this is another topic as well. You know what happens when you meet somebody, Scott? You usually meet their representative. What? At the beginning, yes.
Oh.
At the beginning when the you mass. Meet somebody, yeah. you meet their representative. They tell you everything you want to hear, and at least for me, it only takes sometimes a few hours before, you know, you really find out what their financial situation is, what their professional situation is. And, you know, I use 1 month as a scenario because in a recent situation, it did happen to me where 1 month in, the person fell on a crisis and, you know, I felt enough for the person that I didn't feel it warranted breaking things off completely. Even though down the line, yes, it became a much bigger issue. The whole money thing became a much bigger issue over time. And as a woman, you don't want to feel like you're carrying the person through and through, you know, from beginning to end in the relationship.
Here's a couple comments from the chat room. You know, one of the things Elliot said earlier is, you got to pay to play. Well, you know, hey. What you said, Elliot, that's what I'm saying.
That's a woman saying that?
That's Elliot, you know, what can I say? That's exactly what I'm saying. And then later, Jennifer is saying, remember, we live in an area of Starbucks and coffee shops, so you can have your first date and go to someplace and keep it cheap. But is a woman going to really feel special at the first date at Starbucks?
Well, look, I mean...
It's going to depend on how you've met. I mean, if you've met online, you might want to go to Starbucks.
Correct.
If you kind of know them through someone, then maybe a dinner is better.
What if you've been at a gay bathhouse?
Bruce!
No, I'm sorry. Never mind. That's a personal
respect
joke.
Respect the guest.
That's an inside joke between Scott and I shouldn't repeat that. No, sorry.
No, but actually, Scott, I was going to say that if you meet somebody online and you don't know that you want to spend an entire 3 hours at dinner with them...
30-minute segments.
So. I think it is a great idea to meet up at Starbucks or to have lunch.
Because lunch has a beginning and an end, and I got to get back to work.
No, go to Starbucks and go Dutch there.
Immediately. Dunkin' Donuts. Even better.
You don't want to stop or say, make sure you bring your own coffee and donuts.
Bring your own. Oh, my God. Picnic in the park. Oh, my gosh. Yeah. It all depends on what she looks like, right, Chris?
What? No. Actually, can I just give a shout out? I'm actually dating a great girl.
Okay.
Her name is Jackie. She does her own show on El Nuevo Latino at The Pit, which is on Ustream as well. And we have great dates. And she, you know, whatever I'm saying, it's a generational thing.
Right.
You know, it's completely different. It sounds like what you want. It sounds, some younger women nowadays would see how you're talking about women as being submissive. And it's, you know, it's better, and especially New York City, women are independent. Mm-hmm. It's so intellectual game, and you're from Florida, right?
Yeah.
All my friends say, you go down to Florida right now, I guarantee you one night, I will get pregnant. They say, you're from New York? That's it. Just say you're from New York. In New York, I gotta play chess with them, I gotta bring them to, I gotta tell them I know these people, I gotta skip the line. It's a whole nother game.
Hold on a second, I want to hear about Jackie.
Yes.
But how long have you guys been dating?
I don't know, a couple months. I'm not good with dates. Two or three months.
So in the 2 or 3 months, would you say that Jackie is in a higher income bracket than you are?
She is. She works in a hospital.
Okay. Is Jackie picking up the tab a lot of the times?
No, we go Dutch.
You go Dutch?
We go Dutch.
Really, listen to me. You take that woman out this Saturday, Chris, and you pay for the whole dinner.
You know what? I will.
I say that 100%. Jackie, I got you, girl.
Ladies' choice, whatever you want.
They stick together.
Listen,
they
she's a fun generational thing. You know, we're bringing up this. You know, it's generational. Maybe younger people are gonna feel differently, but everyone likes when someone pays for them. It makes you feel good. It makes you feel special, whether you're a man or a woman.
Yeah,
even if it's not the standard, you know, a woman's gonna feel happier. The guy pays.
Yeah, I'm not against paying for things either.
But don't guys like it when women pay? Is it just me? I like it when other people pay.
Listen, I think
only women like it.
Both parties need to bring something to the table. It's not just financially. It's not just financially. It's a million other things. You want to feel that the person you're with enhances your life in some way. I just think that as a woman, when you're in a dating situation where it's always going Dutch, it's like, well, you know, doesn't he always have to pay for his meal anyway? I mean, you know, you have to I think as a man, at least some of the time, you want to make her feel like you are the man and you're the taking, you're taking charge. And, you know, that's the role you're playing in the relationship. I mean,
where,
is Jack...
Where are all these women that will put up with Dutch time after time? I don't think it's going to happen.
Yeah, no. I don't know that many women that are cool with that.
Also, I feel like in our generation, it's a lot about individualism. There's not the same woman at all nowadays. There's so many different women. You're just constantly just trying to figure out, oh, she's about this. It's just... that's a game in itself. But... we're just very independent people. We go out. It's a great partner in crime type of thing. Mm-hmm. And that's our relationship.
I would also imagine, just based on what you're telling me, if she's not, if she doesn't even have a problem with that kind of, you know, the going Dutch on the dates, and you're 3 months in, I would also venture to say you've probably connected mentally on a much deeper level.
100%.
You probably have a lot of things in common.
A lot, yeah.
And you really enjoy each other's company.
Yeah,
I think it's a modern urban thing of modern 20-somethings in the big city. It's just a new way of life that it's not the old school anymore.
On our dates, she teaches me about Twitter. We talk about Twitter. Oh my god, it's the best. And I'm like, yes, it's awesome. We're both foodies.
He said, "I'll show you my Twitter if you follow me."
You're taking her. Listen to me, Chris. You are taking that woman out this Saturday, and you're paying.
Yeah. Yeah.
What was that, Scott?
She might be tweeting, "He's not paying again."
She has 1,000 followers. I would hate to know though if a girl is calling her friends saying how bad I am. I don't know. That's like a.
According that to the show, 100%.
If I just knew,
Well, listen. At the very least, I think that on the first date, I mean, and listen, I feel you. Because if you're with a girl, if you're on a first date and she's just, you know, not, she's coming across as not appreciative, like you owe her something, like she's entitled,
right.
And it's a kind of an expensive dinner, you know, and if you could care less if you're never going to see her again, make her pay.
It's happening.
Yeah. Make her pay.
Michelle, let me just for the sake of argument, if a guy was good enough in sex, would you mind paying?
Oh. Paying for the sex or
no,
paying
for
dinner?
For the dinner.
Listen, if
I brought something to the table.
Listen to me. If I'm already having sex with the guy,
yeah,
I ain't paying for no dinner. Okay? Now, if we're in a relationship, because that's a whole other topic.
Yeah.
If we're just in a casual physical relationship, the protocol is different than if we're in a relationship. Because if we're in a relationship and I care about you and your you know, your problems and whatever's going on in your life, I may not have a problem paying for dinner. But if we're in a casual relationship, you know, where, and I think there's a movie coming out about this on Friday, Friends with Benefits.
If we're
in a casual situation where we're not in a relationship, but we have been intimate, I absolutely am not paying for dinner too.
Yeah.
No matter how good he is. What he's saying is he's asking if he's really good.
Really good.
Listen.
Yeah, really good.
He is still paying. He is still paying, Scott. I don't want to hear anymore about me putting out and paying for dinner.
Yeah, Scott.
Absolutely not.
And would you be like Jennifer is saying, well, it's okay to take turns, not that big of a deal. Would you be okay if your date pays for the first date and then says, is it okay if you pay for the next one?
Wow. On a second date?
If you're paying already, I wouldn't throw that in there because that just ruined you paying. I'll pay for this one, but you better get me next time.
Listen, I gotta tell you.
Might as well not pay at that point. It's over.
Look, I gotta tell you, because we're making light of the topic, but I've been in a situation, even with guy friends, that I know are in a bad spot financially, and I don't even wait for them to pay. I tell them, listen, I got it today. I do that more often than not. So I'm actually not the one that's always getting, you know, wined and dined and, you know, and treated. And where I never end up, you know, not paying or whatever. So really, it just depends on the income situation, the kind of relationship that you're in. You know, you got to be sensitive to the other person. I don't think you should just discard, you know, a man in your life or a woman in your life because of, you know, one mismatched dinner paying scenario.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. 30 seconds. 30 seconds.
Well, yes. I just wanted to say really quick that Emily's on here from My Life on Match, and she talks about Groupons and stuff like that. And yeah, I think it's tacky to use a coupon for a first date, personally.
All right, listen.
I think most people would agree with that.
I agree. We only have a few seconds. Scott, thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to ask you to come back at a later date because you have a lot of interesting topics to talk about on your website as well.
Okay, great.
Okay.
Thanks for having me. Nice to meet all of you.
Thank
you.
Bye,
guys.
Bye-bye.
Stop recording.
Scott.